Radio 2 is there for you.
When you were doing backing voices on bona fide records, there again, presumably it was for a straight session fee, wasn't
That's
it?
Right, yeah.
Was there ever an instance where you went in expecting to do that and didn't even get that money?
There were some times when we went into a session and we weren't actually needed at all. One would turn up to a session and the arranger had been so busy writing out the arrangement for the orchestra and he'd suddenly say, sorry, I couldn't think of anything for the vocal backing to do, so you can go home, here's your money.
You'd get paid and
do nothing.
And in a real sort of rush session, how many would you cover in a day?
You'd probably cover 3 titles in a session. So, and usually we were working 10 to 1, 2 to 5, 7 to 10, all through the day.
So that alone was a fairly lucrative income without writing at all.
Absolutely, yeah.
And there, though, you would be given the parts that you sang. You didn't have to work them out yourself.
That's right, yeah.
But as you didn't read, what happened then? Did the MD illustrate it to you?
Yes, one would have to busk a bit when you first sort of started to go through the session. And you soon picked up what they wanted. Then they would come over to you and say, ah, oh, this, you know, a bit of harmony there, a bit of low voice there, a bit of high voicing.
Is that another aspect of the popular music business that's virtually vanished?
I think more or less it has, yes. Every time I speak to session singers these days, they're all complaining about the lack of work.
Mm. Does that apply to instrumental musicians as well?
Yes, absolutely.
There's less generally, because people tend to make their own either by pinching bits of other records.
Sampling.
Or
the advent of synthesizers and MIDI music, where you can get absolutely any sound you want without booking a musician.
As you make a great deal of your own music at this stage. Again, something we shall need to return to. I do think it's amazing that the whole industry has changed pace so very much. But do you think, in passing, that that's had a deleterious effect on the standard of music?
Well, I can very much appreciate some of the production work that goes on these days, but I do think some of the spontaneity has gone out of the sound of records, because in the 60s, everyone was there in the studio together, and they were playing together, musicians playing together, create something more than the individual parts. These days, records tend to be done, very much individual tracks and then mixed together in the end. And I think some of the real feel of the music goes out of it.
I think that's probably true. Among the records that you suggested to me might be of interest to us in this programme, there was one by Marianne Faithfull, which I think illustrates the point you're making about the kind of cooperation in the studio.
Yeah. In fact, that was a session done before we joined up with Perry, I think, and eventually became a hit.
And you sang on this?
Mm, yeah.
Did Mick Jagger have anything to do with that one?
I don't think so.
He did, of course, direct some of her records, didn't he?
He did. I think this was a Mike Leander arrangement, as far as I can remember.
But it's got the two voices on there. Good. What about working, John, with other musicians who follow the same sort of pattern? I think a good example might turn out to be The Who. Well, I'm sure Pete Townsend would have worked in the studio in very much the same way as you did yourself.
Yes, and we actually ended up doing vocal backing on The Who's first hit, which was I Can't Explain. Just through being booked for a session, not knowing what we were going to do when we got there, we suddenly got to Pye No. 2 studio, and there was this group thrashing away in the studio.
Wasn't the norm, really, for The Who to use backing singers, was it?
It wasn't. I mean, they were actually, Pete Townsend was a very talented musician and singer, and they all were. And so they actually did all their vocal backing on the later records. But I think in those days, when records were made very much more quickly, and I think probably the producer of that record, Shel Tormey, wanted the whole thing done very quickly in an afternoon session. So we arrived at 2 o'clock and the whole record was made by 5.
And there, again, you were using higher range voices than one would expect to hear on a Who record in general.
Yeah, very much a sort of falsetto sound.
Here it is then, the hallmark of our guest John Carter and a Who record, I Can't Explain.
Can't explain. I'm feeling good now, yeah, but can't know I-